I was told that a clergyman gets paid for being good, but a lay person, like me, is good for nothing. There are times when we need to get our act together and actually do something, because if we don't, well, nothing will happen. And the consequences of this could be pretty grim. Now, this might sound funny, but when I first started drafting, one of the hardest things to determine was to know where to draw the first line. You have this huge sheet of paper, and if you don't get that first line in the right position, it could throw the whole drawing out. One chap I worked with solved this problem by starting anywhere, finishing anywhere. Then once all the views and sections were drawn, he would get a pair of scissors and cut up the sheet of paper and stick them on his board in the location he wanted them, overlay a new sheet of paper, and then trace what he had done. We call it cut and paste these days. But you see, if we don't draw that first line, the drawing will never be completed. Of course, today computers make life a lot easier. Simple things like choosing a scale. That was a problem. How big should I draw it? But now, on the computer, we draw everything full size. And then we draw the drawing sheet to suit it. But these are everyday things, and they're no real challenge. And once you get the hang of it, it becomes second nature. Now, there's a purpose behind every drawing. And if you don't get it right, and sometimes you don't, then you can cause all sorts of problems. But if you want to be a draftsman, these are the situations you must face. Now, I sometimes think that the humble draftsman cops the wrong end of the stick sometimes when you consider he's responsible for gathering all the information from structural engineers, civil engineers, electrical engineers, process engineers, surveyors, environmental engineers, construction engineers, tradesmen, housewives. You name it, I've had dealings with them all. And what knowledgeable people most of them are. But sometimes a misinterpretation or miscalculation can bring all the care in the world crashing down, preferably before construction starts. This is only one occupation, of course, and many people are called to various professions. What were you called to do? I always wanted to be a draftsman, and God granted me this desire. He took a roundabout way, but when I look back, I see God had his hand there all the way, although at times I didn't realise it. And as I've said before, I love engineering. And as I progressed through my apprenticeship, the knowledge of my trade experience I gained put me in a position far better understanding of someone who took up drafting without any engineering background at all. So here I am, a lifetime of drawing lines, and now what? Sure, I still draw the occasional line, but is that the useful part of my life over? As far as engineering plans are concerned, it probably is. But maybe God has other plans for me to put down on paper. There was a baby born at what seemed to be the wrong time thousands of years ago. And he set afloat in the reeds of the Nile River in Egypt. What a start to life. He grows up under the care of Pharaoh's daughter. Experience a life of privilege and plenty in the house of the king, while watching his fellow countrymen suffer under the hands of Pharaoh. All this experience and education for what? One day he kills an Egyptian slave driver for beating up one of the Hebrew slaves, and then takes off to escape the wrath of Pharaoh and gets a job looking after his father-in-law's sheep. Was this all? Is this the only reason God had put him through years of education and training just to kill someone? Well, no, it wasn't. And the story continues. Now, Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and lo, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I'll turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burning. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Then he said, do not come near, put off your shoes from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. I'm sure there must have been a few termites in that too. And now behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring forth my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? And God said, but I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people forth, the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God upon this mountain. Moses' sheep herding days were over. It was time to bring home another flock. The confrontation with Pharaoh and the leading out of Egypt of the Hebrews is not the end of the story of Moses, of course. That was only the beginning. And if you read Deuteronomy, it will continue the story right up to his death. A great man. Why? Because he answered the call from God. Mind you, standing there watching a burning bush that didn't burn and hearing the voice of God would be pretty convincing to me. Is that what it will take to get me motivated? Is that what I want? A burning bush experience? Would I be game enough to say, yes, God, here am I? Trouble is, by saying yes, show me a burning bush, you couldn't refuse a call like that, could you? Moses knew what the problem was with the way his fellow countrymen were being treated, but it seems he was content to look after his father's sheep until the day he died. Sure, he probably thought a lot about it, but plans to free a million slaves was not forthcoming. God had the plans. Moses the one to see them through. What problems do we see in this world today? Now, there's more refugees in the world today than there ever was. Does God have a plan to set them free? If he does, who will he choose? What problems do we see in Australia today? Our lucky country. Should be right, mate. Someone will sort it out. Who will sort it out? What about tea gardens? Hawk's Nest. Do we have any problems here? Is there anything that pricks our consciences? I must admit this is a nice place to live. In my travels around the place, I haven't come across anything sinister, except for the terrorists who delights in pulling the loose palings off my fence once a year. But God got Moses' attention, as he did quite a few people in the Old Testament. Noah, for example, build me an ark, God told me. What's an ark? I once thought. Now that's where a good marine drafting would have come in handy. And Christ got Joshua's attention. In Joshua chapter 5, we read, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said, are you for us or for our adversaries? But he said, no, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have come now. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped him and said to him, what does my Lord say to his servant? Then the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, take your sandal off your foot, for the place you stand is holy ground. And Joshua did so. Different portrait of Christ, isn't it, to the one of him on the cross. You know, God also got Jonah's attention. He got Adam's attention. He got Sarah's attention. And he certainly got Mary's attention. Have you ever tried to get someone's attention when they had their mobile phone on or an iPad in their hand? It's like talking to a brick wall. I had an idea, you know. Why doesn't God send us a text message? I remember once having a meeting with an engineer and his phone rang. I asked him if he was going to answer it. And he said, no, I'm talking to you at the moment. I'll have to wait. And as I left his office, he indicated to me that it was his boss who he had put on hold to talk with me. Now, conversations, especially important ones, or especially the ones that we have with God, are important. Now, are we too preoccupied with the latest technology to hear God calling us? Can't we put aside our event-filled lives to give him a chance to speak to us for just an hour or so? I said to my daughter Jenny about 12 months ago, I said, Jen, take some time and do nothing for 15 minutes. She still hasn't taken those 15 minutes. If she ever does, I'll tell her to try for 16 minutes. I guess with three little girls to mother, her time is pretty well occupied. Try it yourself. Do nothing one day for 15 minutes and give God the chance to break through. It's no good trying to tell somebody something if you don't have their attention. Once God had everyone's attention, he had something to work with. He then went a step further and he called them into action. Does God have your attention? God called him out of the bush, Moses, Moses, and he said, here am I. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped and said, what does the Lord say to his servant? Now I can't speak for the rest of you, but burning bush or not, here am I, God. 70 years old, complete with aches and pains, still a sense of humour. What do you want of me? There's a song sung by a group called Jesus Culture. It's called Never Stop Singing. And the first verse is this. You called out into darkness. You reached out to save us. You conquered the grave. You crossed the divide. Lost in our sin, you made us alive. How can we ever hold it inside? We can't. You know, I suppose age is a reason we are held back to a degree. We can't get around as fast as we used to. But then we don't have to play netball or soccer with our grandchildren to show them we love them. You know, our age, no matter how young we are, didn't come with blank canvases. It came with experience, love, adventure, excitement, and hard work. We're not too old to pass them on, are we? Even if it is just sitting in the lounge in front of a nice warm fire, reading a book, or talking to them. Dr. Charles Mayo met a very old lady who claimed she was 108 years old. Well, congratulations, he said. I hope to see you on your 109th birthday. You will, she said with a smile. You definitely will. I will, he asked. Sure, she said. Very few people die between 108 and 109. You look it up. Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter. and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Then he said to them, "Follow me, I will make you fishers of men." Then immediately, they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. He called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Now, when God calls you into action, will you drop what you are doing and immediately face the task that he's given you? Will you take the time, even 15 minutes, to listen to what he wants of you? It took a burning bush that didn't burn and a voice of God to get Moses' attention. What will it take to get yours and mine? Roland Hill once commenced the sermon by shouting, "Matches, matches, matches." You wonder, he continued in his usual tone, at my text. But this morning, while I was engaged in my study, the devil whispered to me, "Ah, Roland," he said, "your zeal is indeed noble, and how tirelessly you labour for the salvation of souls." At that very moment, a poor man passed under my window, crying, "Matches, matches," very lustily. And conscience said to me, "Roland, you never laboured to save souls with half the passion that this man does to sell matches." If we wish to be called into action, then let us do it wholeheartedly. So let me close in prayer. Heavenly Father, give me the eyes to see what you want me to do. Give me the ears to hear your voice. Give me the strength to follow your instructions. Give me the knowledge through your word to speak the words I have to say. And give me the desire to help those in need. Amen.
So our next song blends beautifully into that, teaching you to dance to the beat of your heart. As God calls us into service, we need to dance to the beat of his heart.